everybody. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with the FF Freak, Brad Nelson, on Magic TV. We're talking about experiences from Grand Prix Oakland, extended, maybe a little bit about audibling. I hear you did that last weekend.
Yeah.
So tell us, what happened?
Well, I tested for like 3 weeks for the Grand Prix online, and I was testing a lot of Zoo. Me and Conley brewed up a couple decks, but Jerry T's deck like ruined our chances of martyring. So I was testing a lot of Zoo and had a really good list, ready to go. And Luis is like, play this deck. So I grabbed my Dark Depths and Hex Mages and went to battle with that instead. And it didn't work out too well.
Did you make day two?
No.
Not even. Okay.
Nope.
So what did we learn?
We learned that no matter what deck you take to the battle, if it's playable and it's not like the worst deck, you just keep with it because knowledge is better than power, in my opinion.
I mean, I've been calling it the Matt Nass effect for like the last few days. Where
really?
It's like, if you've, I mean, again, Matt Nass has always been saying, like, you know, Elves is not good against this, Elves is not good against that. I mean,
mm-hmm.
And it was like, well, you know the deck in and out, you've played it. Like, I can't think of a single person who knows the interactions better. Where it's like, if you play this deck, you're going to have success just because you're not going to make mistakes.
Yep.
You're going to know the optimal play every time. You're going to make the good plays always be tight.
Yep.
And it's like, that outweighs playing what's the best deck by other mm-hmm. people anytime. And I mean, I was in a similar boat to you where it was like, I didn't have as much time to test. I was going to play the team deck because the team had worked on it. And I was like, I'm going to have a little bit of chance to play, but I wasn't going to have as much of an opportunity. I was just going to wing it in a way. And, you know, you and I were playing last week before the Grand Prix, and you first thing you sat down, I was like, you know, oh, hey, Brad, you know, like, what are you playing? And you were like, you know, I know this deck in and out. And I was like,
yeah.
I was very much like, Zoo, like, eh, it's like, you know, not really something like Team Fireball would usually play, but
yeah.
It was like, you know the deck in and out. Like, I'm not going to question you. It was good, mm-hmm. like, you've played dinner matches with the deck, like, you're going to run it, you're going to be good with it. And here you are the weekend before making the same kind of mistakes I did, only I didn't have 200 matches under my belt with anything.
Yeah.
So definitely in the future, going to stick to your guns, like whatever you've tested.
Yeah, and after this weekend, this is the first time I've actually been with Team Fireball to test since I've been here for a week now. And I do think that my playstyle and deck choices are a little bit different. Like, I don't like playing islands ever, really. Like,
Trust me, I am happy you're here. Like,
yeah.
That's a nice thing about playing in a team. Like, Luis and I actually did a show once before where it's like, what's the advantages of playing in a team?
Mm-hmm.
Like, having access to people that play Magic a lot. And it's like, having the wide variety of views is going to help you guys. And playing with better players is going to help you guys. So it's like getting together some of the best Magic players in the world and being like, well, you know, like Jason Mind Sculptor is obviously the card you want to play this weekend. And it's being like, well, maybe not. Maybe I want to play Tectonic Edges and Wild Nacatls and Creatures that Attack. And like having a lot of experience and success doing those things really helps everyone come together and be like, okay, this is the deck to play because.
Yeah, that's exactly true. Like, I do like that this group of people, like, really do have a lot of different ideas, and every deck that we've been testing, somebody has some idea for something, and it's always getting better. Like, you bring your 75, someone's going to tell you four different cards that should be in it. Like, I'm testing Boros right now, and like two different strategies that I added to the deck that weren't from before were from other people, which I really do like. Like, we added Stone Sword Mystic to it. We added Cunning Pyromancer, or Cunning Spark Mage.
Cunning Spark Mage.
Yeah.
Oh, that's some sweet tech
right there. we go get Death Touch Basilisk Collar, we put it on him, and we have this just Death Touch banger. And I've already killed a Malakir Blood Witch, I killed a Baneslayer today, so it was pretty fun.
Whew, huge success.
Yeah.
Hello, Zendikar cards.
Yeah, because, like, they have
or
to kill everything. Yeah, they have to kill everything else, and then you just drop your last card as your kill all your dude card, and I don't know.
Prodigal Sorcerer would be so proud.
Yeah. I mean, I would love to be playing a Timmy at the Pro Tour. Like, Pinger sounds pretty fun.
That would be pretty sweet. You're just giving away tech to everyone out there. You don't
even care. This will go up later, I'm guessing.
You never know. Probably. I don't know. It's such a sweet, sweet card. Like, I just want, like, everyone to know, like, Cunning Spark Mage. You heard it here. Like, Brad Nelson. He's got it. Oh, that's good stuff. I mean, and you know, like, having, not only, like, in my opinion, it's like not only coming up with a card like Cunning Spark Mage and being like, let's play this, but like mm-hmm. throwing that idea out to Luis Scott Vargas, Ben Starr,
yep.
Jerry Thompson, Brad Nelson, and being like, what do you guys think about this? Is like, you know, are you going to laugh me like off the table? Like,
I got a story for you about that. Last night we were testing at Luis's mom's house.
Already a good story.
Yeah, it is a great story because his mom's awesome. Like, first impression of his mom, I like my phone starts ringing, she starts dancing to the music, and I'm like, I get where he gets it from now. And I was outside, we were brewing, me and Tom, and we were talking about how, like, the shapeshifter deck, the blue-green ally, like, how we were trying to figure out what that deck would look like. So we figured out you run the Manixel ally, you run the clone ally, the mill ally, and then you get to 9 mana and you just copy your 1/3. And then you mill for 5x6x6 or whatever it is, for sure. Mm-hmm. And, you know, deck them. And we're like, we should see what they think about this. And we go inside and there's like 10 gamers in the room. And we throw the idea out to everyone. And they just laugh. They're like, that'd be a great deck if there wasn't bolts in the format. And they just ran that one off the table. But, you know, there's a little bit of harshness when you're testing with everyone here. Like, everyone has strong opinions about everything, but
I mean, that's great. That's the thing about coming together with this many pros is, like, they've all had enough success to, like, shoot you down. So it's if I even, like, walk up to the edge of the table and, like, even, like, mention a card, it's always like, any one of these guys can just tell me to stick it, and I'm like, okay, I understand.
Yeah, you can't do anything about it. You get shut down, and you're like, okay, I'll go build Boros.
but Brad Nelson said that deck's good. Like, come on, guys, right? Like,
I didn't say it was good. I said, let's build it.
Right. Like, well, it's at least worth testing. Like, throwing Shapeshifter into the gauntlet would be cool.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. I don't really see where the connection between that and Spark Mage is, but at least it's like...
Well, like, if you have a good idea and you give it to a lot of good players, they'll respect you. If you give a bad idea to them and they, you know, like, ridicule for it, then, like, every time I come up to them with a new idea, I'm kind of like... Should I tell him?
Dude, that was the same guy that told us to play Shapeshifter. I don't know about this guy. He's going to be gone next year.
Ouch.
I'm saying that's what they would say. Like, to me, obviously, I'm
yeah, I know.
I'm not Brad Nelson. Well, that's sweet. I mean, I don't know. I really hope I see that card this weekend, but who knows?
I
mean,
I'm pretty sure that there is going to be an ally deck this weekend.
Yeah.
I would call it, actually.
And again, that was something I was talking about with everyone else who sat down. It's like, this format is so wide open going into this mm-hmm. weekend. There are so many different viable decks. But there's been no, like, you know, Jerry's very blunt about it. Jerry's like, you know, pros didn't care. Like, you know, this set came out. They had no reason to play it. Like, you know, this is going to be the first time where the guys that really play the hell out of these cards are going to have an opportunity to show you what the best stuff is.
Yeah.
And so it's like, you know, laziness be damned. Finally, we're going to see, like, all the excitement from this new stuff that's come out.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I think it's going to be a really good tournament. Like, I just hope there's, like, 4 Sparting Thronex in the top 8. I want to see some diversity. Because, like, what happened at Worlds with all the diverse formats, like, after Worlds, the top 8 decks weren't the best decks in the tournament. And, like, this was the first time I was ever part of a tournament like this, and, like, I saw that. Like, there's so much tech out there. And if you didn't dig enough, like, I went back to my FNM, and, like, everyone was playing the lists from the top 8s. And it's, mm-hmm. like, dig around, because there's a lot better ones. So, like, being that this is a little bit more standard, I think the best decks will shine. So I'm pretty excited about that. Like, just to see how it branches off from the Pro Tour.
Yeah, I mean, again, like, 35% gen at Worlds, like, immediately going from there and seeing... Seeing the format change so much. I mean, Luis had a very poignant win at the beginning of mm-hmm. January where it was like, you know, if the format's going to be so stagnant like this, we're just going to play a deck that beats that deck. Like, yep. And there you go. And it did
and
it.
He broke the format and just, you know, it was kind of like the dark cloud just went away when we saw sunlight.
Yeah, I was fine. I was like, it's not even like the red, white, blue deck was this amazing, unbeatable, like, combination of cards. It was just like, if you guys aren't going to do anything and just play the same deck, I'm going to play the deck that beats that, and then you're going to do something else.
Yep.
And from there, we've seen a lot of great vampire decks. I mean, Boros is in so many different varieties. Yep. Again, those green-white kind of stuff, you know, knights and Elspeths and Slayers.
Those are really popular online.
I still want to see, like, some combo decks come out there. It's like, always cross the fingers, and it's going to be the whole rock, paper, scissors, and not just some beatdown and some control. And
trust me, I tried every combo you could play in this format. It has to be creature-based.
Even Matt Nass has finally, like, gotten off the rock of, like, the Howling Mind deck, which was, like, his thing. And it's like...
I tried Ascension. Tried it forever. Put it on. It's fun. It's probably the funnest deck in the format. Just taking infinite turns and not having to play a dude at all. You know, ramping up and drawing a bunch of spells.
Like,
it's
turning
so
off
much
all
fun.
The removal is, like, the whole point of playing the control deck. But, like, it just hasn't been there for everyone that I've talked to. So who knows? Like, you know, I'm interested to see what Connolly's going to brew up. I mean, he's such an innovative deck designer.
Yeah, I know. This is the format where he's going to give us yet another deck. I know it. Like, it's Connolly. He'll build something off the wall that'll probably be positioned pretty well.
Sweet. Well, check for all of that kind of coverage and articles over here at channelfireball.com. And thanks for tuning in. Thanks for being here with us, Brad. Hope to see you more.
Thank you.
All right.